So the topic of my talk will be mainly about a family of reinforced random walk. So I will define later what precisely I mean by that, reinforced random walk. So what is this reinforced random walk? In two words, I will define precisely what it is, but it's a family of some processes that have a tendency to come back to their past trajectory. Okay, so there's a reinforcement in the sense that they want to come back to sites where they have visited in the past. And okay, so for this part, it's not really related to the topic of the school, but what I will try to explain today, maybe not today, but in next lectures, is how this is related to random Schrödinger operator or Anderson localization. So. So for those who were at the conference at the school last week, it was the content of the course of Simone Wartzel about random Schrödinger operator. I will not use what she said. Okay, but so I will explain in the talk. So let me. Okay, so what I will explain clearly in the talk is how this model of reinforced random walk are related to some model of field theory, which is a sigma field. Okay, don't need to know what it is, but it's something like some hyperbolic generalization of the Gaussian free field, if you know. And okay, and this field is related in some very non-rigorous way to the course of Simone Wartzel, Anderson localization. So that's the first relation to Anderson localization. So I will recall in a few words what is Anderson localization. And what I will state also precisely in this course is how this field is related to a random Schrödinger operator. So this will be rigorous. Okay, so and this is also related to this reinforced random walk. Okay, so let me just remind what I mean by Anderson localization. So, so in few words, so okay, don't need to know what about the course of Simone Wartzel, but. What is Anderson localization? It concerns the spectral properties of the random Schrödinger operator, which has this form. You take H naught. So imagine that you're on ZD. And consider ZD as a graph. So H naught is the adjacency matrix of the graph. And you look at this adjacency matrix plus lambda times a potentials, which is IID potential on the vertices. And okay, so that's a random operator on functions on the D. And the question about localization and delocalization, which was the content of the talk of Simone last week, is the following. There's the general picture, let's just to state, I will not state, I will just state part of what she explained last week, but one content which is important is that for lambda large, which means that when you have a strong disorder in the potential, so when lambda is large, then what you expect, in fact, what is proved rigorously at least under some conditions on the random potential, is that this this operator H lambda has a pure point spectrum. So that's just introduction, so I don't, will not define precisely, but what does it mean, pure point spectrum? It means that this operator has a basis of L2 eigenfunctions. Okay, this operator has a basis of L2 eigenfunction, and these eigenfunctions are localized in the sense that they have exponential decrease, so which are exponentially localized. So what does it mean, exponentially localized? It means that you have a basis of eigenfunctions which are in L2, and which essentially have this form. If you take a point, say zero, okay, it's localized around some points, so which means that you have a function which looks like okay, you may have oscillation, but you have exponential decrease in the distance of the with respect to the distance to some points to the origin. Okay, so that's the what is called the localized phase of the random Schrödinger operator, which means that you have a real basis of L2 eigenfunctions with exponential decrease. Okay, this means that okay, it's like in finite dimension, you can write your operator as a decomposition and projection of the L2 eigenfunction. And what is conjectured is for lambda small. And this is the main conjecture in this. Is that for d larger or equal to 3, so in dimension 3 and more, then for lambda small, what is conjectured is that this is no longer the case, and that there is inside the spectrum there is a part which is delocalized. Okay, so I don't want to be very precise in this this respect. So it means that part of the spectrum looks like a delocalized eigenfunction, so it means that you have what are called extended states, so which are so it means that you cannot write the spectrum as you cannot decompose the operator on the basis of L2 eigenfunctions, but the spectral resolution of the spectrums of the operators, it gives, it contains some extended states, which so which may looks like a sinus or okay, very delocalized. Okay, and that's the main conjecture about the random about Anderson localization, so our Anderson model. So you see that here you have so this operator, it's H naught plus some IID potential. So what will be the relation with this reinforced random walk? In fact, what is somehow conjectured and understood some partly with this correspondence there that I will explain later, is that for this reinforced random walk, the localized regime corresponds to some to recurrence of the random walk, and the delocalized regime will correspond somehow to not somehow, but corresponds to transcends of the process. Okay, so that's very very vague introduction, but it will be mainly the content of the course. So let me say that this dotted arrow, so this is far from being understood, and it's not even clear that it has a real meaning. Okay, so the idea is that there is a okay, the Anderson model can be interpreted in a non-rigorous way in terms of some model of supersymmetric sigma fields, and in fact there is a sigma field that is associated with this reinforced random walk, but it's a toy model for the family that is supposed to be connected to the Anderson model. Okay, so there's a many things which are far from being understood in what I draw there. Okay, so first, it's a toy model for the real thing. And secondly, even for the real thing, there's no clear connection in mathematical terms. Okay, so I will not be able to explain this. But
do you still have the bottom thing?
Excuse me?
Do you still have that bottom box?
No, this is okay. This one, okay, so let me say, what I will state clearly is that these two things are related to a random Schrödinger operator where the potential is not IID, it's one dependent, so there's a dependence at distance one, and in fact, it's only at the bottom of the spectrum. So in fact, the correspondence between the rate force random walk and this process will appear at the bottom of the spectrum. Okay, but it will be clear, more clear in the talk. I hope. Okay. So, all this is rigorous somehow, but it does not give me any information on the real Anderson model. Okay, so let me now start. By some simple thing. So before I define what is the reinforced random walk, let me remind some simple thing about some classical probability. So the finity theorem. So maybe, probably, part or most of you knows that very well, but I will nevertheless remind. So the finity theorem. And Polya-Hern. So, okay. So, why do I remind that? It's because it's the ideas which are contained in this definite theorem and the Polya-Hern. They are the base of most of the ideas that appear in the description of the reinforced process. So let me state the definity theorem in its simplest form. So what is the simplest form? Is you suppose that you have a random process xi that takes values in two points, 0, 1. Okay. Then you say that it's exchangeable. The process is exchangeable. If for all n and all permutation of one n so you take the permutation of the first n integers then the law of the permutation of the n first variable okay if you look at the permutated n first variable it's equal in law to x1 xn okay so it means that the law of the process is invariant by finite size permutation. Yes? And then there's the beautiful definity theorem. Actually, it was came, I think, from Bayesian statistics. It says that if you have such an exchangeable process, then it's a mixture of IID sampling. So let me state it more clearly. So state definity in this simple form. So it's clear definition. What is exchangeable? So the definity theorem says that if you have an exchangeable process, then first, if you look at the asymptotic statistics of the number of 1, so if you look at 1 over n xi, then this converges almost surely as n tend to infinity to some random numbers, random number p. Okay, this p may be random, and conditionally on p, then the xi, they are iid, and if they are iid, and the statistic is p, then it's necessarily iid distributed as Bernoulli random variable with parameter p. Okay, so that's the classical definite theorem in the simplest form. Okay. Okay. So you see that you have some asymptotic statistic, and then conditionally on this asymptotic statistic, then the process is simple. Here it's IID. Yes, it's clear. So now let me come to the typical example of this theorem. It's the Polya-Hern. And then you will see that there's something, okay. And this somehow will be the prototype of what is going to be to appear in the course, but in more complicated form. So what is the Polya-Hern? So you take an urn with balls of two colors, let's say red, and you have red balls, which are white there, and then you have blue balls, which are green.
How about white and green?
Well, okay, white and green. Okay, so you have white balls and green balls. And okay, so let's say that at the beginning you have a white ball, and b green ball. Okay, and the Polya-Hern, it's the following simple process. What you do is that you pick at random one ball in the urn, okay, and you put it back. So you pick a ball, and then you put it back in the urn, but with an extra ball of the same color. Okay, it's clear. So if you pick a white ball, then it means that you add one, so you put it back and you add a new one of the same color. Okay, so in this case you have four white balls and three green balls. Yes. So that's the Polya-Hern. So who knows the Polya-Hern? Almost everybody. Good. And okay, so it's very simple to see that the Polya-Hern, it's so if you think at the sequence okay, so if you look at the sequence that describes the balls that have been picked, so suppose that that zero is white and one is green, then it's an exchangeable process. Okay, let's say that it's an exercise, very simple. Okay, you can compute easily the probability to pick some sequence, and then you will see that it's exchangeable. Okay, and there's an extra information that you can get. So it means that you can apply the definite theorem. And the good point here is that if you look at the, so it means that you have some asymptotic statistic. If you look at the asymptotic number of white balls that you get, it's the p, and the p has an explicit law. And the extra information you get in the Polya-Hern process is that p, the law of p is explicit, and it's a beta random variable, beta AB. So what is beta AB? So that's a distribution on 0, 1. And what is the distribution? It's proportional, so it's p to the power. So the density of this random variable, it's p to the power 1 minus a minus 1, 1 minus p to the power b minus 1. And of course, it's on 0, 1. And then there's a constant. So in general, in probability, we never write constants. But you will see, I hope that at the end of the course, you will see that in this subject, constants matters a lot. So I write the constant. So it's gamma a plus b divided by gamma a, gamma b. OK? So I will prove that because it's two lines. You don't need the affinity theorem to prove that. And it's very simple, and it will be somehow a prototype of what will be in the rest of the course. OK, so what does it mean? It means that the polyahern, you can state it differently. You can say that, OK, the polyahern, if you look at the distribution of the polyahern, you can say differently, you can state this theorem differently, you can say, okay, the polyahern, it's a mixture of IID sampling. So it means that you integrate, it means that you first pick P at random, and then you take IID Bernoulli according to P. Okay? So this is why I write it by P to the P. So this is IID sampling Bernoulli parameter P, and then you integrate with respect to the beta, okay, I write it like this, beta AB the DP, okay? That means that you first pick P according to beta, and then you take IID sampling, okay? It's clear that it's the same thing. So let me now prove that, I give a proof of that because you will see it's just two lines if you take it in the good in a good way. So it's a clear statement. So let me prove this formula. It's very simple. So how to prove that without the affinity and without anything? It's quite simple. It's something like Bayesian statistics, if you did Bayesian statistics at some point. Is that OK? Let's start in the reverse direction. So we start by this integral, OK? And we want to prove that if you take expectation with respect to this p, then you get the polyahern, OK? So suppose that you start from the right-hand side. So if you look at the probability that x n plus 1 is equal to 1, conditioned on the fact that x1 is equal to epsilon 1 and xn is equal to epsilon n. Okay, these are 0 or 1. Okay, and you suppose that you have k. So what did I? Okay, I don't. I should put. Okay, let me. Sorry. You have to put. A corresponds to the white, so it means that you have to put 1 when it's a white and 0 when it's a green. Otherwise, it's you switch AB. Okay. So suppose that you have K1 and N minus K zeros. Then this is very simple. It's just so you have two integrals. So you say it's the probability. It's the integral of the probability. Okay, let me write it directly. It's the probability to first pick this one and then a one. So it means it's p times the probability that in the first place you pick k. K ones and n minus k zeros. So this is just this because you have fixed the sequence. Okay, and then you integrate according to a beta. And you divide by the same thing, but you don't add the last term. So it means that it's p to the key. So you divide by the probability to get the first sequence equals to that, so it's p to the key to the k, 1 minus p to the n minus k, and integrate according to the beta law. Okay? It's clear? Yes? But now what you see is that this is again a beta integral. Yes? So you see that you have just the ratio of two constants that you know very well, which are exactly the normalization of the beta law. That's why I wrote the normalization. So you see that this is the integral of the density of the. So you have the. So what do you have? You have the ratio between the integral of p to the k plus 1 plus a minus 1, 1 minus p divided by n minus k plus b minus 1 dp, divided by the same thing, but you don't integrate the last one. You have k plus a minus 1, 1 minus p, n minus k minus, b plus n minus k minus 1 dp. Okay? So that's just a ratio of gammas, and that so it gives that's gamma a plus b plus n plus 1 divided by, okay, I don't write everything, but if you make the computation you will see that it's just a plus k plus 1 divided by a plus b plus n. Okay, so it's exactly the probability to pick the n plus 1 ball, 1 condition on the past. Okay, so that's the same thing as for the Polya urn, because that's the configuration of the Polya urn if you first pick k white ball and n minus k green ball. Okay? It's clear? No? Okay, so why did so that's a simple computation, you agree? And but I did it precisely because it will be somehow a prototype of what is going to appear in the rest of the talk. So for us, it will be a prototype of what I will call explicit definity theorem. So you will see, I will do a more complicated proof of the same type later. So what is an explicit definity theorem? So it will not it will be more complicated, so it means it will be related to Markov chains and so on. But what is the principle of the explicit definity theorem is that you have some asymptotic statistics with explicit and interesting law. Well, interesting, it's a matter of taste, but with explicit law. And the second point is that conditionally, so here it's the P, and conditionally on this statistic, the law of the process is simpler. So it means that you have some type of Markov property of the process. Here, Markov means that it's IID, but more generally it will be some independence in the process. Conditionally on this statistic, the process is simpler. Okay? And you will see several occurrences of this. Yes. And somehow, once you have such a picture, you don't really need to have a definity theorem. If you have the if you can guess the explicit law of the process, then you can do the same trick as here, and then you get directly the fact that the mixture has the law that you expect, that you want. Okay. So now let me. Okay, of course, the polyiron, if you have not, okay, let me not describe it precisely because I will not need it, but if you have more than two colors, if you have k colors in the polyiron, then there's an explicit law which is called the Dirichlet law. You have exactly the same thing, but with a Dirichlet law. Okay, but I don't want to describe it. I will just say a word later about trees, but okay. Random walk on trees, but okay. So that's the first point. So second point. So I will define what is the edge reinforced random walk. So you will see that it's a type of polya type Markov chain. So it's a edge reinforced random walk. Edge reinforced random walk. And I will explain what is the correspondence of the definity theorem in this case. So partial exchangeability. Cool. So what is the, okay, sometimes it's also called linearly edge reinforced random walk. So you will see later why, it's not clear why. So I will nickname will be ERRW. Okay, so what's this this object? So it's take a graph. So vertex with vertex set V and edge set E, which is a non-directed graph. It's a non-directed graph. And suppose that it has finite degree at each vertex. Okay, that it's connected, otherwise it's not very... Okay. And on this graph, you... you put some weight on the edges. You put some positive weight on the non-directed edges. Okay, so what's the linearly edge reinforced random walk? Then let me first not give a formula but draw a picture. So imagine that you start at I naught. So you have some weights, A1, A2, A3, A4. So what does the process do? At time zero, it looks at the weights that it sees, that are the weights of the edges that are neighboring the initial edge, and then it jumps according to the with probability which is proportional to the weights. Okay, so imagine that it jumps to this edge. Then it increases its weights by one. Okay, so at first it jumps according to the weights. Once it crosses an edge, it increases its weights by one. Okay, but it increases the weights in both directions. Okay, in this direction and in the reverse direction. Okay, so once you are here, then then you see a weight a plus one, a one plus one, and then you have a I don't know what, and then you jump with a probability which is proportional to the weight. So you see it's reinforced because you feel the fact that you already crossed this edge in this direction, and so you have a tendency to come back. So that in this sense, it's reinforced. Okay, and then you continue. If you come back, then you have a plus 2. And then you increase here. If you cross this edge, then you have a 4 plus 1, and so on. Okay, and then you always increase the weights by 1. So if you want to write a formula, then it's simple. If you look at the probability, if you have x which is neighboring y, if you look at the probability that x n plus 1 is equal to y, knowing that xn is equal to x, and knowing all the paths, okay, knowing x naught, xn minus 1, then it's equal, it's proportional to the weight of the edge at the time n, so it's axy plus the number of time, okay, so this is the number of time you have crossed the edge x1 in the past, divided by ax, so I will define ax, plus the number of time you have visited the edge, the vertex x at time n. Okay, so what is ax? So it will be the standard notation. Ax will be the sum on all the edges that are neighboring x. Okay, so that so all the edges connected to x. And n x y n, it's the number of time before time n that the process in non-directed sense is equal to x and y. Okay, so it means that's the number of time you have crossed the edge in the past. And nx, it's the sum with this formula, so it means that it's the number of time you have crossed the, you have visited the vertex x. Okay? It's clear definition. So let me make a remark. So there's an important remark. Which is simple in the picture. It's not clearly stated, but it means that it says that if A is small, A small corresponds to strong reinforcement. And A large corresponds to weak reinforcement. Okay, why? It's very easy on this picture. It's because if you have A which is very small, if you look at the first time you cross this edge, if you have A which is very small everywhere, so it means that you have to compare the first time you cross this edge, then you have to compare 1 plus A compared to A in the rest. Okay? So it means that you have a very strong reinforcement when A is small everywhere. Okay? And when A is large, then you don't feel the fact that you have increased the weight by 1. Okay? So you have these two regimes, and okay, so second remark, which is important. So this process was introduced by, Diaconis and Coppersmith. So somehow, I think it's, okay, it was also in the thesis of Pimentel, which was supervised by Diaconis. So I think that Diaconis is behind this. Okay, so Diaconis is at the origin of all these type of processes. And okay, if you read this, the motivation he gave was that he was working in Paris and that he was taking streets randomly and that he has a tendency to come back to the street he already knows. That's the official motivation. If you, in fact, if you look at the...
He was giving the talk in Paris, right, when he said that.
Yes.
Well,
actually, I don't know if it's right, okay. And, okay, so that's the official motivation. In fact, there's something much deeper in his motivation, I think, is that if you look at the publication of Diaconis at this time, then there's something like 10 or 15 papers on the Definity Theorem. And I think that is really real motivation. And I guess that he understood that this process was interesting because it has some exchangeability property. And it's also related to Bayesian statistics. So I think his motivation, his real motivation, was the Definity Theorem. And probably also Bayesian statistics, which is one of his specialty. Okay. So now I come to the point of why is this process interesting. So you see there's a choice in this process. So it's called linearly reinforced just because you increase by one. Okay. So there's no reason to increase it by one, except that you can say, okay, it's good when it's linear, but there's no other motivation, then it's not clear that for all process it's good when it's linear, okay? So there's a deeper reason why this process is interesting and more interesting than somehow other. You could take these weights to some power, for example, which would give a different process. Or this times log of blah blah, anything. But there's a deep reason for why this process is interesting. It's related to the Definity Theorem. And so it leads us to a theorem of Diaconis and Friedman, which was in fact before the introduction of this H-reinforced random walk. So that's a Definity Theorem for Markov chains. Okay, so let me give a definition. So the idea is that you would like to have something that, so you see that the Definity Theorem says that when you have a process which is exchangeable, then it's a mixture of IID samplings. You would like to have something similar, saying that when you have a good property on the process, then it's a mixture of Markov chains. And that's the Diaconis-Friedman theorem. So before I need to state a definition, if you have a random process on suppose that it's on a graph, but you don't need that it's on a graph, but you can always take the complete graph. Then it is partially exchangeable. If if for all path gamma, so if you have a path gamma which is equal to gamma naught up to gamma n, then the probability that y naught yn, so that y follows the path gamma, then this only depends on the number of crossings of directed edges. Okay. It depends only on the number of crossings of directed edges. So it depends only on the number of crossings of directed edges by gamma. And let me write something which is useless in this case, but I write it anyway, and the starting point. So it's clear the definition? So it means that it only depends on the number of time if you have a graph. It's partially exchangeable if it only depends on you count the number of times you crossed each of these edges, and it only depends on the number of times you crossed the edges and not the order. So it means that the probability to do, let me write something. Okay, so the probability to do this, this, and this, this is the same as the probability to do this, this, and this, and this. Okay?
Do you assume that yn has to be a walk? I mean, if you take this edge, you cannot jump. It has to be a walk.
Okay, you don't care. Okay, it can be. No, I mean, it's. Okay. I say that it's on a graph, but you don't care that it's on a graph. Okay, it's just on a set. But you can always take the complete graph, and that's and in this case, okay. It's clear? Excuse me? There's something that, no?
That is the number of what?
The number of crossings of directed edges. Okay, so it's the number of, for each edge, x, y, it's the number of time. It's the number of time for k equal 1 to the size of gamma minus 1 of gamma k plus 1 is equal to x and y. Okay? So it only depends on this. Yes? On the family of all these. Okay? But that's for directed. Okay? I count directed in this case. Okay, and I will say that it's partially exchangeable and reversible. So you take respectively and reversible. Okay, if it depends not on on the number of crossings of directed edges, but non-directed edges. So respectively non-directed edges. It's clear what I mean. So it's partially exchangeable if it depends only on the number of crossings of directed edges and the starting points. And it's partially exchangeable and reversible if it only depends on the number of crossings of non-directed edges. Yes? So it means that in this case, it depends on the set of n. Okay. It depends on the set on all edges. It depends on the For all edge, it depends on the family of n e gamma, which is the sum. You have the same thing of, but now you count the number of times this couple non-directed is equal to is the edge e. Okay? It's clear? So now, maybe you can guess what is the Diaconis-Friedman theorem. Actually, I already said it more or less. So, what is the theorem of Diaconis and Friedman? Okay, so. This process, the edge reinforced network, I don't remember exactly. I think it was introduced something like in the 80s. I don't remember exactly when, but in the 80s. And this theorem is also in the 80s. So the theorem says it's a definitive theorem. So it says that, but here, of course, it cannot be a mixture of IID sampling because if you have a graph, for example, you know that you jump only to neighbors. So it cannot be IID sampling. But it says that if yn is recurrent, so which means that it comes infinitely often to its starting point, infinitely often. Okay, so you need a condition about recurrence, But if you have one point which is recurrent, if the initial point is recurrent, then in this case, if yn is partially exchangeable, respectively reversible, then it is a mixture of Markov chain. Yes? So what does it mean that it is a mixture? It means that you have a random probability on the set of Markov chains. Yes? You have a distribution on the set of transition probabilities. And the law of y is equal to an integral. Let me write it a bit vaguely, but okay. I will be more clear in the case where it's reversible. Okay, so it's so what does it mean? It means that the law of e y is an integral on the These are transition probabilities on the graph. Okay, and you integrate, you have a law on transition probability, and then you take the law of the Markov chain with this transition probability. So it's a random walk in random environment. Yes. And when it's partially exchangeable and reversible, then it's a mixture of reversible Markov chain. So in this case, I will be more clear about what it means because it's what we will be interested in. So, respectively, mixture of reversible Markov chains. Okay, it's clear the statement? Yes. So, in the case where it's when it's a mixture of reversible Markov chain, then it's easy to describe. So just remind that if you have a reversible Markov chain, on a graph, on the graph G, it can be described by conductances. By a set of conductances okay, any reversible Markov chain can be described by conductances just by the probability to jump probability to jump from x to y. It's okay, I have a mixture of notation. Let me switch to I and j. The probability to jump from I and j, it's xij divided by xi. Okay, and any reversible Markov chain can be described by conductances. Yes? Yes.
It's an
if and only if. It's very easy to see the reverse direction, okay? Because obviously a mixture of Markov chain is partially. Excuse me.
It does not imply the recurrence, right?
No, it does not. Okay. Yes. For the partial exchangeability, it's if and only if. Yes. So, so what does it mean on the edge-reinforced random walk? So if you apply it to the edge-reinforced random walk, So application to ERRW. it means that one point which is not completely obvious, which is not difficult, is that if the graph is finite, I will explain why later, but okay, is finite, then the ERRW is recurrent. That's quite simple, but okay, if you have a finite graph, then the ERRW is recurrent just because it grows linearly. So by Borel-Cantelli type argument, you see that you cannot stay in a finite box. You have to visit every. And there's another argument which is more direct. But okay, so if you apply the theorem, so it means that so now the thing is that the edge-reinforced random walk is partially exchangeable. And reversible is partially exchangeable and reversible. So, why? Okay, I leave it as an exercise, but you can compute exactly the probability that the ERRW follows a fixed path. It's quite easy to see that it's the product on all the edges. Okay, I take a notation. I will use several times this notation. At least once. This notation A, comma K, it's A, it's the product of all. Okay, it's the product of a plus 1, a plus k minus 1. Okay, so it's quite easy, and that's an exercise, to prove that the probability that you follow a fixed path, then it's the product on all the edges of a comma, that's the number of times you have crossed the edge for gamma, divided by the same for the vertices. Okay, that's just recurrent, one-line recurrence, it's completely obvious. Okay, so you see that it only depends on the number of times you have crossed the edges, because these can be computed from these if you know what is the starting point. That's an exercise, but it's quite easy. Yes?
You need linearity for this? No, right?
No, you don't. No. For the normalization, you need the linearity. Otherwise, you have instead of having ax plus the number of times you have visited the edges, you will have ae plus, you will have the sum of the normalization, and that's not linear in the. I mean, you cannot say that if you have alpha there, then it will be alpha there, because the normalization will not be there. Okay, and it's partially exchangeable and reversible. And so it means that, so what does it mean? It means that you have a mixing measure on reversible Markov chains. So, so it implies that for all starting points, for all initial weights, there exists a certain measure that depends on the starting point and on the initial weights. On what? On the set of conductances. And you can always normalize so that one specific edge is equal to 1, let's say. so there exists such a measure, such that the law of the ERRW with initial weights A and starting from I naught, it's the integral of the law of the Markov chain in random conductances x starting from I naught, integrated against the measure mu. Okay. So now you can say what's the Okay, you can ask what is this measure. So the important point is that this measure, in fact, depends on the starting point, and it really depends. Okay, and the second thing is that that's a theorem of Diaconis and Coppersmith. They were able to. I will not write the formula, but. They were able to compute the measure mu. Okay, I don't write the formula because I will write several formulas later. So I don't write this one. It's in the exercise sheet of tomorrow. And the thing is that once you have this measure, and if you know that it's a probability measure, then you can prove directly, exactly as the same as for Polya-Hearn, that it's the mix that the edge reinforced random walk is a mixture of this reversible Markov chain. Okay, that's a direct computation. If you know that if you can guess what is the formula, what is the measure, and if you can prove that it is normalized correctly. Okay. But okay, it will be in the exercise. I will write the formula.
A priori that
you're walking recurrent. No. I mean that's okay. That's on finite graph. Okay. G finite. What I state is that you have an explicit formula for this measure, and if you know that this is a probability measure, then you can prove that it is the mixing measure of the edge reinforced random walk directly by direct computation. Okay, so I don't prove Diaconis-Friedman theorem. Just let me say one word about the proof. In fact, the proof is quite clever, but it's not extremely difficult. There is a very simple. Okay, so if you want to prove the Diaconis-Friedman theorem, so you want to prove that if you have a process which is partially changeable, then it's a mixture of Markov chains, then the idea is that you can use the standard definity theorem. So you look at, you know that you have, the starting point is recurrent, so you look at the sequence of cycles. So the sequence of cycles is a sequence that lives in the set of cycles, which is some nice Polish space. And it's very easy from the partial exchangeability to prove that this is exchangeable in the classical sense. Okay, because you can flip cycles just because it's partially exchangeable. So you can flip cycles. So it means that you can apply the standard definity theorem to the sequence of cycles. So it says that the cycles are a mixture of IIDs. Okay, and then the trick is to prove from this that the law in these cycles are the law of Markov chains somehow. But you can prove that conditionally on the standard definity theorem, then it is a Markov chain. Okay? Conditionally on the asymptotic distribution of the cycles, then the process is a Markov chain. And that's the tricky part. But the first step is very easy, and you use the standard definity theorem. Okay, so let me now come to what is known. So the plan of the course is, in the first course I will talk about the probabilistic part, but I think I will be slower than what I expected. But so now what I would like to do is to explain what is known in this process. And in particular, that's a type of motivation for the rest, and to show that there's a phase transition in dimension 3 and more. And So, okay, so let's say that it's three. What is known on the ERRW? So the first result, of course, was this result of Diaconis and Coppersmith about the explicit mixing measure, which was, okay, if you look at the exercise, you will see that this measure is rather puzzling. And you will see several other measures which are puzzling. But but there's a special case, which is much simpler. And this case was investigated by Pimentel, I think, in his PhD thesis. So the first case which was treated, where the behavior of the H-reinforced random walk was understood, is the case of trees. So that's Pimentel, also in the 80s, I don't remember exactly when. So let me state it in the simplest case. So I think it was more general, but suppose that you have a binary tree, D-array tree. Suppose that you start from the root, and you look at the edge-reinforced random walk, which has constant weight, constant initial weight. Then there is a nice simplification in the case of the tree. So why? Because there's what's the main property of a tree is that if you go in one branch of the tree, and then if you come back, you have to come back by the same edge. You agree with that? And that's the characterization of tree. So it means that if you look at what happens at the vertex, so imagine that you look at the edge-reinforced random walk. So if you look at the first time that the edge-reinforced random walk reached this vertex, then you see that the weights at the first time when the edge-reinforced random walk reached this vertex, then the weight is a plus 1 on the edge coming from the root, and it's a on the other edges, okay? And then each time you come back to this edge, so it means imagine that you choose to jump to this edge, then suppose that you come back, then when you come back, necessarily you have increased the weights by 2. Okay, because you have no choice except to come back by the same edge. So it means that each time you choose an edge, then you can consider that you increase the weights by 2 for the next time you have to come back. Okay? Yes, it's clear? So it means that if you look at one edge, one vertex, then the situation is a Polyar-Hurn. That's a standard Polyar-Hurn, and they are independent on each vertex. Yes? Because the initial weights is A plus 1, A, A. And that's a Polyar-Hurn where you increase the number of balls by 2 each time. But increasing the number of balls by 2 each time is the same as taking initial weights which are equal to the half of the initial weight. Yes? Okay. So you can see that what happens at one vertex, it's independent of what happens at the other vertex, okay? At the other vertices. Yes? It's clear? So it means that the process is governed by independent Polyar-Hurns. Yes? Okay, so that's the it's clear. So you know now that Polyar-Hurn, there are mixtures of IID samplings. So it means that for each vertex, you have a Polyar-Hurn, independent Polyar-Hurn. So it means that in this case, the ERRW is the same as a random walk in random Dirichlet environment. Why Dirichlet? Because it's the mixing measure of Polyar-Hurns. Yes? For example, if you are on Z, you have just two, so it's a mixture of beta low. And you see that you have a push to the origin because the weights of this polyiron, the initial number of edge of balls in this edge which goes to the root is A plus 1 over 2, and the others are A over 2. Okay? And from these remarks, then it means that it's a random walk in random environment on trees. And in this case, it has been, in fact, that was the main content of the paper of Pimentel, to prove that, that you have a phase transition depending on A. And so if you take so the theorem of Pimentel, states that if you have a D array tree, you suppose that D, okay, D is the number of edges. I don't know what's the D, if D is the degree or, okay, but that, let's say D2, it means that at least binary tree. Then there exists a certain value strictly positive such that if A is smaller than A0 of D, then the ERRW is positive recurrent. So what does it mean here? It means that it's a mixture of positive recurrent Markov chain. Okay? So it means that the number of times you come, the proportion of time you spent at the origin is positive. Yes? And
I missed the argument. Why is this? Why are the spoilers independent?
Ah, because okay, it means that you can couple the ERRW with independent polyirons. Just because if you go in this branch, you increase by one, but you know that whatever the process does, the next time it goes back, the weight is A plus 2. So it means that the process is the same. If you look at independent polyirons and edge-reinforced random walk, the process is the same. Because the weights of the polyiron, each time you come back to a vertex, the weights of the polyiron will be the same as the A weight of the ERRW. Yes?
Sorry.
No.
Now, what happens if I just go one way many times, forth and back, and the one edge, let's say the upper A, I never go that way? So.
Yes, you don't care because you will not use the next step of the polyiron. Okay, if you never come back, that's not a problem because you will never use the next step of the polyiron. So I agree that if the process goes to infinity, then you have A plus 1 there. But you will never have to use the next step of the polyiron. Okay? So it means that the polyiron and the process do not finish with the same vertex, but each time you come back, they have the same weight. If you are transient, at some point, you don't have the same weight at infinity. But you will never use it. It's clear or not?
Maybe you have to insist that the polyiron is a mixture of IID. It's not an asymptotic result.
No. But the question is whether why the polyirons are independent. So what I mean is that if you take polyirons or independent polyirons on vertices, and you run the process with these independent polyirons, and in parallel you run the process of the ERRW, then they have the same law. Yes? Because each time you come back, then you have the same configuration.
I think that there is one little positive fact is that you may only use a finite number of drawing your polyiron for
yes.
one vertex. And so you use a finite version of a polyiron.
Yes.
Like if you sample 17 times from a polyiron, it's as if you were first sampling this beta or this dirigeable
yes.
guy.
Yes, because if you look at the first n step of the polyiron, it's the same as if you take a random environment at the beginning and sample 70 times from this random environment. That's still a polyiron earned even if you sample a finite number of times. Yes? Okay. So once you have that.
I don't even understand what this Dirichlet environment is.
Okay, that's. Okay, it's because I didn't define it. The Dirichlet environment, it's. Okay, that what I want to explain is that it's independent polya urns. Okay, now in a polya urn, what is the Dirichlet environment? It's the same as the beta the Dirichlet law. It's the same as the beta law with n coordinates, k coordinates instead of two. So it means that it's a law on random vectors of size k.
What is k?
K is a number. It's the number of it's the degree of your it's three there. It's the degree. Okay. And then you look at, you have a law on random probability on k points. Okay, on a set of size k. And the distribution is the product, it has density product to the ai minus 1, where ai is the weight. Okay.
I see. And these are okay. So these are not the edge weights. These are the transition probabilities. Right?
Yes. The p are the transition probabilities, and the edge weights appear as the parameters of the law, as in the beta law. Okay. The initial number of balls appears as the parameters of the beta law, and if you have a higher degree, it's the same. Yes. Okay. It's true. I didn't define the Dirichlet law, so. Okay, so where was okay? There. So the result of Pimentel from this representation, it says that if A is strictly is more reinforced, okay. If A is smaller than this A naught, then the ERW is positive recurrent. So it means that it comes back infinitely often. In fact, the amount of time it spent at the origin has a positive proportion. And if A is larger than this A naught of D, then the ERRW is transient. Okay, and if A is equal to A naught, then it's weakly null recurrent. Okay, and that I will not prove that, but that's an exercise. It's a paper about random walk in random environment. Okay. And okay, so now I would like to explain in the last quarter what we know on the case of ZD. Okay, so of course, when you have such a result, you would like to know whether this is the effect of infinite dimension of the tree or if it's the true for ZD. And let me state what we know, what is known on ZD. So before, let me make a remark about how to use the representation of Coppersmith and Diaconis in this case. Okay, so imagine that you're okay. So consider the case, the simplest case where the weights are constant. So suppose that you are just, okay, it's more general, all the results that I will state are more general than that, but suppose that it's that the weights are constant, so it means that you are on ZD, and you have a constant weights on the constant initial weights on the edges. So the question you ask, and that the question that that Diaconis ask at the beginning, is whether this process is recurrent or not, or whether there's some recurrence. Or okay, in dimension one, it's easy with the argument of Pimentel to prove that it's always positive recurrent. Okay, but in dimension more than what than one, it's not easy. And okay, so how to use the Diaconis-Friedman representation? So the idea is the first idea is always the same, and it's simple, is that you take a big box and you start at zero. And the thing is that if you take a big box, you know that you have you're on a finite graph, and you know that the edge reinforced random walk on this big box, it's a mixture of Markov chain, reversible Markov chain, with conductances XE. Okay. So the idea is that you would like to have a control on the size of the conductance. Okay. So if it's localized, so it means if it's positive recurrent, then you expect that the conductance decreases, either exponentially or polynomially or so. Okay. So what you would like to have is some control. What you would expect, for example, is some exponential decay of conductances. So for example, something that I will not prove, but which is not very difficult to prove, is that, for example, if you can prove that for some S strictly positive, then you have a control, you have exponential decrease of, okay, you need to renormalize. All these conductances are up to a constant, so you can always divide by the conductance of the initial starting point. So if you have a control, if you can say that this is exponentially decreasing, for example, if you can prove that some moments of the conductances is exponentially decreasing, then it's rather easy to prove that by some weak theorem that it is a mixture of positive recurrent Markov chains. Okay, because you can take a weak limit of the mixing measure, and then you have exponential decrease of the conductances. Then in this case, this implies that you have that the ERRW on ZD is a mixture of positive recurrent Markov chain. Okay? I don't prove that, but it's rather simple. Okay, you understand that if the conductance decreases very fast, it's localized. Okay, so that's somehow what you would like to prove, and then you see that this boils down to understand the mixing measure mu. So you have consider the X as some random field, and you would like to have exponential decrease of the random field.
You may have the impression that it's too much to ask.
What? It may be too much to ask, yes, it's not clear whether it's too much to ask or not. No, it's not clear whether in dimension two, for example, it will be true or not. Okay, so the first result in this direction was by Merkel and Rolles, but unfortunately they could not deduce anything about the ERRW, but nevertheless their result is very nice, and it's for D equal 2. And what they could prove is that their you have some polynomial decay. It's 1 over the norm. Okay, you have a constant, any constant. So you have some polynomial decay of the conductances for some psi A strictly positive. Unfortunately, if you have Xi which is larger than 1, then it implies recurrence of the ERW. If Xi is between 0 and 1, then it does not imply anything. But nevertheless, they could prove this this result. And if you remember about the talk about Simone Wartzel, somehow this corresponds to the things that she said that for Anderson model in dimension 2, it would be maybe easier to prove, I think it's extremely difficult, but okay, to prove polynomial localization or some polynomial localization of the Green function by using some Mermin-Wagner argument. And in fact, behind this result, it's a Mermin-Wagner argument. Okay, but it's not for Anderson, of course, but it's for this specific model. And they use explicitly the law of mu. Okay, and okay, I have 3 minutes, so now maybe I can state what we know on then there have been some progresses in the last 5 years, and many people were involved in this result. In particular, there have been some, and that will be the aim of the next talks, some very important work coming from very, very different subjects, from mathematical physicists, Di Sartori, Spencer, and Zirnbauer. And I will explain later what, and Di Sartori and Spencer, about the sigma field. And okay, that was in 2006 and 10. And I think it was it's clear that it was a key. It was absolutely not related to the H-reinforced random walk, but it was key steps in what was found later. And so let me state what we know now. So I state it only on ZD. So for any D, okay, it's for any D, in fact, for D equal 1, it's true, but it's there exists some value A such that if A is smaller than A inf of D, then the ERRW is positive recurrent. So it's a mixture of positive recurrent Markov chain. Okay, and this was proved independently by myself and Thais in 12, and Angel, Crawford, and Cosma, who have a very nice proof just from the what they explained up to now. And it's much inspired also by this work of Di Sartori and Spencer. Okay, so it means that in any dimension, there is a positive recurrent phase for the process. Yes? And okay, the interesting fact is that in dimension 3 and more, there is a phase transition. And this phase transition is, okay, Spencer says that it's the same type of phase transition as for Anderson localization. So, I mean, say type, I don't understand what it means, say type, but so, in dimension 3 and more, there exists some parameter A sub of D such that if A is larger than A sub of D, then the ERRW is transient. Okay, so it's interesting because there you have a phase transition depending on the initial weights. When the initial weight is very low, you have very strong reinforcement, and then you have positive recurrence. But when the weight is large enough, then the reinforcement is weak, and then it's transient. Okay, and okay, let me say that. So this was. This is due to Di Sartori, myself, and Thares. But in fact, it's very much inspired by the work of Disertori Spencer and Sandbauer. Okay. It will be more clear later, but so there's a, in this proof, there's a huge contribution of Disertori Spencer and Sandbauer. Okay. And now with Zeng, which is there, in dimension 2 and 3, and then I will stop. Okay, I'm late. Okay, what we could prove is that for dimension 2, so it's with Xiaolin Zeng, in dimension 2, then we can prove that the ERRW is recurrent. This is related to random Schrödinger operator. And also a CLT in dimension 3 and more. Okay, so what I mean is that it's possible to prove recurrence, but not positive recurrence in dimension 2. And it's not clear whether it should always be positive recurrence. It's probably always positive recurrence. And it's probably always exponentially localized, but it's not clear. And in the transient regime, then it's possible to prove a CLT. So you have diffusion of the process. Okay, I don't know if it's clear. So the aim of the talk tomorrow will be to explain the relation with the work of Disertori Spencer and Sandbauer, the localization, the sigma model, to introduce another process which is called the vertex reinforced jump process, which is related to the edge reinforced on the book, and to explain also the relation with the random Schrödinger operators. Okay, sorry.
Other questions?
Yes?
So, can you describe the measure that selects the sample the conductance is
collecting? I cannot hear.
Can you explain what the measure looks like for the sampling of conductances, at least in the deregular tree? Because, for example, to compute this mean of the S moment, I guess we are using this kind of.
You cannot compute the S moment. Okay, I can write the formula if you want. The first thing is rather simple. It's the product on all the edges of the graph. That's the Diaconis-Coppersmith formula. And then you take the conductances to the power AE minus 1, so it looks like the Dirichlet distribution that I wrote somewhere. And you divide by the product on all the vertices of the weights, the conductance of the vertex to the power AI plus 1 over 2. And then there's a subtle thing is that it depends on the starting point. And the way it depends on the starting point is that they are square root of x. Okay? So it means that it gives an extra weight to the configuration where the initial conductance is the conductance at the initial points is large. Okay? Because this pushed the conductance to be large. But the difficult thing is that you have a square root of something which is some difficult term, which is a determinant, and it can be written as the sum on all spanning trees of the product of XE. So this can be written as the determinants of the Markov generator of the Markov chain. Yes? Okay, this is the same as you look at the matrix that has value XIJ on the line I and J, and minus XI on the diagonal. And you take some minor, and you take the determinant is the same as this. That's the matrix tree theorem, if you know. I don't know if you know, but. Okay, the difficulty is this term, because this is a very nonlinear term. And it's a term that correlates the values very far. And the thing is that in the case of tree, then you know that there's only one spanning tree on tree. That's and so in this case, you have just one term. And that's why the measure is simple in the tree case. Okay, but the difficulty is that once you have such a measure, then it's very difficult to analyze anything because of this term. Because it's non-convex measure, so it's and I didn't write this one because you will see tomorrow another one which has the same form, a bit simpler. And there's a constant, important constant.
Okay. So if there is no other questions.